Good morning. Welcome to Mass at St. Gregory the Great. My name is Ray Geska, and I will be your lector for this Mass. Our celebrant today, this morning, will be Father Dan Ulmer, assisted by Deacon Greg Gowan. A few announcements this morning. Family faith formation classes will start in mid-September for pre-K through grade 10. Please remember to register at stgregs.org. Sponsorships are now available for Oktoberfest and for the Christmas craft show. You can see the bulletin for more details. Please read the bulletin for more information on pre-K sessions, a Bible study on the book of James, registration for RCIA, the Knights, Night of Prayer, Sunday Choir, Parish Children's Choir, and much more. Readings for the liturgy this morning are located at 1257 in the Gather Book. That's 1257. And at this time, I ask you to stand and welcome those around you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, as we gather to celebrate this 21st Sunday in ordinary time, let us call to mind our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries.
Lord Jesus, you were sent by the Father to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you come to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you sit at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting.
Glorify you.
Let us pray. O God, who caused the minds of the faithful to unite in a single purpose, grant your people to love what you command and to desire what you promise, that amid the uncertainties of this world, our hearts may be fixed on that place where true gladness is found. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Joshua. Joshua gathered together all the tribes of Israel at Shechem, summoning their elders, their leaders, their judges, and their officers. When they stood in ranks before God, Joshua addressed all the people. If it does not please you to serve the Lord, decide today whom you will serve. The gods your fathers served beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose country you are now dwelling. As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. But the people answered, far be it from us to forsake the Lord for the service of other gods. For it was the Lord our God who brought us and our fathers up and out of the land of Egypt, out of a state of slavery. He performed those great miracles before our very eyes and protected us along our entire journey and among the peoples through whom we passed. Therefore, we will also serve the Lord, for he is our God. The word of the Lord.
In spirit, he says, but out of them all the Lord delivers him. He watches over all his bones. Not one of them shall be broken. Taste and see the goodness of the Lord. Taste and see the goodness of the Lord.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Brothers and sisters, be subordinate to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives should be subordinate to their husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is head of his wife, just as Christ is head of the church, he himself the Savior of the body. As the church is subordinate to Christ, so wives should be subordinate to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ loved the church and handed himself over for her to sanctify her, cleansing her by the bath of water with the word, that he might present to himself the church in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. So also husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one hates his own flesh, but rather nourishes and cherishes it, even as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak in reference to Christ and the church. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, Lord.
Many of Jesus' disciples who were listening said, "This saying is hard. Who can accept it?" Since Jesus knew that his disciples were murmuring about this, he said to them, "Does this shock you? What if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life, while the flesh is of no avail. The words I have spoken to you are spirit and life, but there are some of you who do not believe." Jesus knew from the beginning the ones who would not believe and the one who would betray him. And he said, "For this reason I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted him by my Father." As a result of this, many of the disciples returned to their former way of life and no longer accompanied him. Jesus then said to the 12, "Do you also want to leave?" Peter answered him, "Master, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and are convinced that you are the Holy One of God. The Gospel of the Lord.
A couple years ago, I was in Hobby Lobby, and I love going to Hobby Lobby because you're always surrounded by all these Christian messages because they have all this decor that has all these Christian signs on it. And by the way, it's a great Christmas gift to give our friends who are fallen away Catholics with like crafting, because then they have to go into Hobby Lobby to buy stuff, and they're surrounded by all these Christian messages to make them think about God. But anyways, I was walking through Hobby Lobby, and I happened to notice this one sign, and it said, "For me and my house, we will serve the Lord." I was like, oh, that's kind of interesting. So just kind of, you know, went on my way, kind of filed it away. But then later, you know, as I was, you know, in preparation for today's homily, I was thinking about, what does it mean for me and my house to serve the Lord? You know, in today's first reading from the book of Joshua, this is, of course, where this comes from, where, you know, he says that as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. And what's going on in today's first reading is that there's this temptation for them to go worship these Baals, these false gods, and these idols. And what Joshua is doing is he's giving them a pep talk. He's saying that, you know, the Lord did all these great things. He brought us out of the land of Egypt, out of slavery. He did these great miracles before our eyes. We need to remember that. We need to remember the wonderful things that the one true God has done for us, and that's why for me and my house we will serve the Lord. And it's so easy to be tempted to go off and to worship these false gods, to go off into things that are seem more easy or pleasing or pleasant. But this is where Joshua is saying, no, don't go worship those false gods. For me and my house we will serve the Lord. Now, sometimes we have these situations where it can be challenging for us to follow the true faith, for us to really want to, for me and my house, to serve the Lord. And one of those challenging teachings we have is, as an example of that, is today's second reading from St. Paul's letter to the Ephesians. And we know that our modern ears, it's very difficult for us to hear that we called wives to be should be subordinate to their husbands as to the Lord. But in order to understand what's going on here, we have to dig a little bit deeper into the passage. And we need to think about whenever the Lord or whenever Jesus talks about leadership in the Bible, or he talks about leadership in the kingdom of heaven, what does he talk about? He says the last will be first and the first will be last. So this isn't some sort of like power trip that's going on here, but it's actually a relationship out of love. So if I draw an example for this, so I as a priest, you know, I am called as a priest not to have my power to lord it over you or to use it for my personal gain or to make millions and millions of dollars, which is not going to happen, don't worry. But if I did that, that would be sinful, right? That would be going against my vocation, what the Lord has called me to do. But I am called to lead the flock and to shepherd the flock because I love you. I am called to lay down my life for all of you out of that self-surrender of love. And of course, the best example that Jesus gives us out of love is he says there's no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. And of course, this is what Jesus does on the cross. He lays down his life. He literally dies for us out of his love for us. So just as Jesus loves his bride, the church, out of love, so too I who act in the person of Christ am called to love the church as well. And just as a husband, in the exact same fashion, is called to love his wife as Christ loves the church, out of that profound self-giving love, where he's willing to lay down his life for his family. And we see that this is why a marriage is a resemblance of the Trinity, because there's a relationship of love between marriages between three people, husband, wife, and God. And so too, the relationship of the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, is a relationship of love. And this marital love is a reflection of this relationship of the Trinitarian love. And this is where husbands are called to love their wives, and in return, wives and children are called to love their husbands. And we see how this is that relationship of true love that's resemblant of that self-giving love of Christ. And this is how we love as Christ has called us to love. Now, in today's gospel reading, we also see that the disciples are struggling with a hard saying. And, you know, Jesus even, like they even said, like, this is hard, who can accept it? And Jesus even asked, does this shock you? And he goes on to say that what if the Son of Man, going up and down, and of course it's an allusion to the Old Testament. But we see that this is a shocking teaching. And remember, for the past few weeks, we've been praying through John chapter 6, which is the bread of life discourse. So we see that the disciples are having trouble with understanding what does it mean for Jesus to give of his body and blood for us to eat as our Eucharistic food. I mean, Jesus uses the word literally like to chew or to gnaw on his flesh. So they don't understand what this means. And instead of staying there to understand, many of them, they go away because they can't understand this teaching. And of course, it's interesting that this happens in John chapter 6 at the end of the Bread of Life discourse. Because when we think about Christianity today, what is it that truly divides all the Christian denominations? And most of it revolves around the Blessed Sacrament, the Most Holy Eucharist, being able to receive Jesus' body, blood, soul, and divinity under the veil of the sacrament. That's something that we believe that because of the Bread of Life discourse, that we're able to receive so many graces from receiving the Blessed Sacrament, because Jesus tells us in John chapter 6 that he gives us his bread, his body is true food, and his blood has true drink. And that's what we come here at Mass, and we are able to receive out of that gift of God's divine love, him giving of himself, so that we can receive those graces we need to carry out the good work the Lord has called us to, and to have that gift of faith. But this is where Jesus goes on to say that he knew from the beginning the ones who would not believe and the ones who would betray him. So Jesus knew this would be a hard teaching, and he's referring to Judas Iscariot. He knew that he would be betrayed. And this is where the gift of faith is a gift from our Heavenly Father. Jesus said, "For this reason I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted him by my Father." My brothers and sisters, this is where we celebrate this gift of faith that the Lord has given us. We celebrate that he has drawn us here to receive his body, blood, soul, and divinity under the veil of the sacrament. We are grateful for that gift the Lord has given us to believe. And this is where, when it's a challenge to, when we're tempted to kind of go away and, just like in today's first reading, to go to follow things that are more pleasurable or more fashionable, things that lead us towards sin, things that lead us towards money, power, status, all those things that lead us away from Christ. We are called to come back to the true teachings of the church. We are called back to the teachings of the faith. And we are called to say, just as Simon Peter said when Jesus asked the apostles in today's gospel if they also wanted to leave. Simon Peter says, "Master, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe, and you are convinced that you are the Holy One of God." That is what we are called to hold on to. When we don't understand something, we're called to seek that understanding, and we're called to live that life of love. But as Jesus also said, his words are spirit and life. And this is where, when we follow Jesus' teachings, when we follow the gospel messages, this is what's going to give us true happiness in this life and in the life to come. And this is where we always need to be mindful of that, how we're called to live out the teachings of Christ and his church to the fullest, out of our self-giving love, that we're called to resemble love in the way that Jesus loves us. We're called to give of that love. But all of that comes from being focused on following Christ and being focused on having me and my house serve the Lord. Because without making that resolution for me and my house to serve the Lord, we're going to lose sight. We're going to go astray. But we always need to be focused on God. So today, as we come forward to receive the Holy Communion, Jesus Christ, body, blood, soul, and divinity, under the veil of the sacrament, let us be grateful for this great gift of his profound love. And may the graces that we receive from receiving the Blessed Sacrament always draw us closer to Christ. And may we always have that courage and fortitude to, in the difficult moments, to not run away from Christ, but as the apostles did, to always come back to our Lord and to profess that for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Let us together profess our faith using the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. With faith in our loving and merciful God, we bring our prayers and petitions before our Heavenly Father.
For the Church, that those in ministerial positions will lead us to embrace a commitment to justice and peace across the world and in our local communities. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For world leaders, that those entrusted with civic leadership will look beyond their own needs and work toward establishing lasting global peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our community, that those who return to school will be blessed with a year of enrichment in mind, body, and spirit. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our family of parishes, that those who find the teachings of Jesus too difficult to put into practice will be inspired by our word and example. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the unemployed, that those who face the challenges of unemployment will be comforted in their distress and soon find the employment that will bring them fulfillment and stability. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Harold Wagner, whom we pray for in a special way at this Mass, and for our own prayers and intentions, which we offer now in prayerful silence. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who have died will know the eternal love of God in heaven, especially those who have passed on this week from our parish and faith community. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God, our Father, we ask you to hear these prayers, those we voice out loud and the many more that we hold in the silence of our hearts. Hear and answer them in accordance with your most holy will. And we ask this as we ask all things through Christ our Lord.
Our ushers will now take up the collection. Our gift bearers this morning will be Kathy and Dan Massing.
Thank you.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. O Lord, who gained for yourself a people by adoption through the one sacrifice offered once for all, bestow graciously on us, we pray, the gifts of unity and peace in your church through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for you so loved the world that in your mercy you sent us the Redeemer to live like us in all things but sin, so that you might love in us what you loved in your Son, by whose obedience we have been restored to those gifts of yours that by sinning we had lost in disobedience. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks, as an exaltation we acclaim. To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Michael, our Bishop, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants. And all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you the sacrifice of praise that I'd offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers in all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven to you, O God, his almighty Father. Giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you."
In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands. And once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which would be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us, through this participation at the altar, receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with a sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, to those sinners, hope in your abundant mercies. Graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who will live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer each other that same sign of Christ's peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Draw near, take the body of your Lord. Draw near, draw near.
Let us pray. Complete within us, O Lord, we pray the healing work of your mercy, and graciously perfect and sustain us, so that in all things we may please you, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We have a couple of announcements. If you or someone you know is thinking about becoming Catholic, now is the time. RCIA starts Wednesday, September 4th. Please see the bulletin for more details. Alpha is coming to our family of parishes starting in September. Do you know someone who could use an invitation to connect with others while exploring the meaning and purpose of life? Please read the bulletin for registration information regarding Alpha. And as always, we hope that all of you have a wonderful and a blessed week. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. This Mass is now ended. Let us go forth in peace and in joy to serve the Lord and one another.
Thanks be to God.